So. So we kind of like thread this resource counter through. Now we have queue resources now, so we kind of like move the focus to the E, and step E prime, Q prime, the counter might go down rather than the counter now. So then at some point you want this value, so then possibilities, if all type. So it can either be nil, start with that one. So then, yeah, in this case, we have to do what? We have to execute the E1, and the resource counter remains unchanged because we didn't do one of these ticks, so we won't change it at all. So if it is cons instead, and yeah, as I said, we have a value, E1 prime, and our values. So then we want to evaluate the E2, but of course we have to substitute E1 prime for. So this is how that works. The rule for cons skip. The thing I want to point out is so we still have the preservation theorem. Do I want to mention some of the type rules? Maybe I also want to mention some of the type rules. Resource analysis later anyway, but I want to at least show you thing. Just type in the same context and in the same type top. So, okay, and so these are the only rules I want to show. You get like an idea of what the other rules look like later on anyway. So, but the thing I want to point out is that type soundness is now at least somewhat broken. Yeah, so let me maybe just give an example. So yeah, if you have pick one unit and zero resources left, right, so then there's really no E you can step to. Because you're out of resources, you have zero, you would have to pay one, right? But you can always find at least. So a queue to put here so that you can step. So if you have got that closed expression E, then either E is a value or exists a queue such that E and Q step to E prime Q prime or so something we have, but this is not totally satisfactory. So what we really want is kind of like that the type system tells us what you know Q we need to put there at the beginning so that we never run out of resources. So this is what we want to do now. Every step allowed to pick a new one, then it works. Yeah. Okay, good. So let's maybe do an example that I will use as a running example. So, and what you can already do now, you can do a resource analysis by hand, and this is something you can do at least a little bit. So, and as an example, I use the identity also shows you how to use this fixed point haptic form. And now we have this function and we have our cost model. So now let's say we define just a list of lengths n, the unit list of lengths n. Just a bunch of units and so we have n of them. So then we can ask a question. So if we evaluate the identity on the end, what do I have put here as my like initial counter if I want to end up, we know the outcome will be the end again because it's the identity, but you don't care so much about that here, you just care about the resource cost, yeah. 2n almost. Oh yeah, no, 2n is correct, yeah, sorry. I changed it last minute and added these ticks, and yeah, so I thought like we had cost one for the application, but we don't have it. So, okay, yeah, so n. So basically, I mean, we don't know if this is a type bound, but you know, that's also something we can prove now. Yeah, we could prove like by induction on n that this holds for all vn, and so in this way, kind of like we did a complexity analysis of this function ID. We could then be more ambitious, and we could also say kind of like there is no smaller initial counter that we can put in there, and then we would know it's a time bound. But from this already we know this is a time bound. And our goal is now to do exactly this analysis with the type system. So let me go on for just a little bit before break. Our goal but we're gonna do this like kind of like in a particular way. I already said it title of the lecture, so we're going to use type-based annotized analysis. So the idea of this analysis is that, maybe you remember amortized analysis from your algorithms course. So what you do there is we define a potential function, every kind of like state of your program, you have some potential around, and you can use this potential to cover the cost. And here in our case, we only have this potential to cover the cost. So the potential, if you want, is kind of like a lower bound on this resource counter at this particular point in the program. But the potential can, of course, depend on your data structures, on the length of your lists, for instance. This is the idea. So the types really define this potential. There's no kind of like runtime representations of it. And this potential has to be used to pay for ticks. So how do these potential types look? Well, let's just define it and then I explain what it means. So it's a usually recursive definition. So at some places in the type system, we're gonna check these potential annotations Q. Again, this is a positive rational number, and read syntax is something like this, and tau. Just write it like this. And the idea is that in order to run this function, you have to have this potential Q around, and after you're done with the function, you get this potential Q prime back from the function. But there will also be some potential that can depend on the argument here. So, and this is defined by the list, so the lists also have this A, right, which is such an annotation, and I usually write it like this. I put this up here on the L. And this means that you have potential Q for every element in your list. So in this way, we have a potential function that can depend on the length of the list. And of course, you could also, A could also be a list, right? And could also have like an annotation, and then the potential you have depends also on the inner lists. And not on the like maximum of the inner lists, but on each individual inner list. So we'll see this like in a second. And we also have the unit to deal with, but the number changes is just unit. So these are the potential types. And question?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Can we revisit it?
Yeah, so the error type, the meaning is to run the function, you have to pay q, and you get q prime back. Yeah, that's a net cost, basically. So the difference between them is a net cost, but you need to keep around both because you want to track the high watermark, right? So it's not always the case. So there are some functions where you might need two at the beginning, right? And you get two back, but you can't just have zero and get zero back. That would work. So, good. So I define what this potential is right after the break. I just want to do a couple more things. So so we have a context where we have a mapping from the variables to these types. Tau, not A, so that's why I want to write it down. And so then we can use our running example to already build some intuition. So the IP could be assigned later in the type system. Potential 2 for the initialist, because remember the cost was 2n for the length of the list, so that's exactly the potential you want to ask the client of the function to provide for running the function. And yeah, that's all you need. You don't need anything constant. And then afterwards, all this potential is used up, so you have zero potential left, zero constant potential, and zero potential on the list. So what is this potential good for that comes out of the function? Well, sometimes you have maybe different function. So let's say you have something like this, where you want to apply ID twice to the argument, something like this. So then, what is the cost of running this function? Well, it's 4 times the length of the input list x. So this function, you might want to assign a type like this, L4. Okay. Okay, so, but yeah, we talked about this more, of course. Yeah, question?
Yeah, below the L4 on the last line, what is written? It looks like a 0/2, maybe?
Wait, which one?
On the last line.
Yeah.
Below the L4.
Oh, so that's 0/0.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. That makes more sense.
Yeah.
So here we have two types of the same function.
Yeah, so that's a good question. Yes, so we have two types for the same function. That's a bit confusing. So the best way to think about it is like that for each function, you have kind of like a set of annotations that go with it. Yeah. Yeah.
You also need to then build like sort of an equivalent state, are they equal or equivalent?
Yeah, right. So I mean, okay, so that's like jumping ahead a little bit. So you can have like a kind of like most general type for something like ID, where you would say you have some kind of like unknowns here, Q and Q prime and so on, and some kind of like constraints on what they can, and then you can describe kind of like all the possible types. But for now, let's not go there. So, I mean, if you remember that kind of like, you know, each of these IDs is its own kind of like fixed point definition. So for now, let's just say like, you know, every function has exactly one type, and these are two different functions, right? Because the ID is like this fixed point, and for this one, we select this type, and for the other one, we select the other type. So that's all that we want to talk about here.
Can I ask what the effect would be if you nested another ID to get three IDs?
Yeah, that would be the innermost one would be 6 to 4. Okay, so then we have a break now, 5 minute break, and then we talk more about it.
For like having the turnstile, super Q, sub Q, whatever. And then separately now we have this notion of tick, which is sort of like in one case we had a cost model that was somewhat independent of the program, that like you just wrote the program and separately compared a cost model to it. But now we're embedding ticks into the program and analyzing it as such. So like, why do we have these two different formulations? Is it more useful to do this analysis when the ticks actually embedded into the program?
Right, so okay, the question is what is the relation between the tick cost semantic that we defined today to the stuff we talked about yesterday. So the short question is, the short answer to this question is, so the stuff we defined yesterday, so that's a real deal, so that's kind of like the way you really want to specify your cost. But if we do it with these ticks, it's a bit of a simplification because we only have to in the cost analysis account for having cost at one place, so it makes it a little bit more elegant. And so it's kind of like a fair game to do that because you can, you know, choose a cost metric and, you know, have your cost semantics as defined yesterday, and then you could have kind of like compiler phase that would insert all the ticks into the program, and then you would do the analysis in this like intermediate program. And for the and you don't have to do it like this. So all I'm going to tell you, and I also going to come back to that when we talk about soundness, applies basically to the other cost models. So you could use any of the cost semantics that we had yesterday, improving the sound with respect to this one.
Yeah, just to point out, if somebody downloaded that subsingleton implementation that I pointed out about. So in that implementation, we use exactly this approach. So there's four different cost models. and then your program gets compiled into one where the ticks are explicit, and then that's get type checked. So if you want to play with it, you can look at the program before and after the cost model is being applied.
Okay, good. So, let the value of tau, then the potential maybe should be consistent with my notation. I should use the other one, so. That's exactly what we said before, kind of like, so we have this, you know, L of tau and Q, then you have Q potential for this element. So, example, you have a list. we have five countries per element, overall potential is 10. Yeah. And in general, if you have a list of lengths n, elements called A, one, two, A, n, and you have two potentials per element. Yeah, again, this is just another way of writing this type. About that. So that would be Q times n plus, of course, all the inner potential, right? Because you might have a list of lists, so you don't want to forget about those. All the AI under. Okay, good. So then 15 minutes left to talk about the actual type system now. Roughly, the intuition is that the potential defined by Q and the data structures, you feed into it, and their potential is defined by the types in gamma, so that this is sufficient to pay for the cost. You don't run out of resources, and then you have some potential left that is specified by the Q prime and by the type tau. So that potential then would depend on the value that results from the computation. So, but we'll see that in detail when we look at the problem. So, let's just start with the rules. And the rule for variables is already interesting. So here you see there's no context gamma that we have drawn. So the only thing we allow to have here, there's nothing here. The only thing we're allowed to have in this context here is this variable x. So all other things we have to consume elsewhere. Right? So there's no kind of like leftover we allow. So what that means is essentially, and you'll see with the other rules, that we have to use every variable exactly once in an expression. The other thing that's interesting is, of course, the constants we put here. So here we say, okay, to evaluate the variable, we have to have zero potential, and then our left is zero potential. And it's kind of like, yeah, the same spirit that we are not allowing any excess, right? So you could say, well, it would also be fine to start with Q for some arbitrary Q and end up with Q. And yeah, that's correct, but here we are like super restrictive and we say, okay, you can't have anything in excess there. Okay, why not? Yeah. We'll see later on, we will allow to have Q and Q here, but this will be separate rule. Kind of like a weak rule. Talk about later. So that's also cool in the function application. So here now, yeah, in the spirit that we have like right now a linear type system will be affine, which means yeah we can throw things away, but that yeah we're gonna achieve with certain rules. So now let's just say we have to use all the variables once. So now we have the context gamma here, so we have to decide now where we're gonna use the variables. Yeah, so we're going to split up this context in gamma 1 and gamma 2. And if I write something like that, gamma 1, gamma 2, so then what I mean is really that the variables in gamma 1 are distinct from the variables in gamma 2. So especially if I would write something like gamma, comma x tau, that would mean the x of gamma. So, okay, here we have to find, you know, some split up of the variables, and then we have to also have some initial and resulting potential, so we can find here. And okay, what do we do now? So we have the potential around that is in the data structures in gamma 1, like the list and so on. And we can consume this in the evaluation of the E1 along with the Q. I want to call this here. You want to call it R. The gamma 1 and the Q is going to pay for the cost of the E1, and we have R left. And so this is now. Hopefully a function type, otherwise we would check the program. So let's say P and Q prime. And then what we have to do is we have to put the gamma 2, so the potential we have around here in the list in gamma 2, together with the potential R, we put it into the E2, and now what we expect is that we have type tau. So now, kind of like in our head, what we would have to do is now we have to evaluate the function body, and the cost for that is given by this type of this E1 here, right? So then what will happen is, so we have left hand, So we have the potential that we have around after evaluating the tool is given by P, and the type tau here, yeah, which kind of like is assigned to the result of the evaluation of the tool, which is exactly what we plug into this function. So here we have exactly this tau and P showing up. And we validate the function body, then what we have left is Q prime and tau prime. So this is how you read this rule. Yeah, so the potential kind of like flows to the program. If you just look at the constants, yeah, and you would assume for a moment that we don't have this potential on the lists, but then it's pretty clear, right? You start with Q, then you get R. So then you're done with evaluating the E1, then you have R, then you evaluate the E2, you have P, and then you do the function body, so you take it there to P, you have Q prime left, and that's how you end up with the Q prime here. And the same you basically also do with the potential of the data structures. It's only a little bit different in the sense that you kind of like split it up here, and there's no potential really flowing out of the E1 that goes into the E2, except you have this flow of potential here from the tau into the function arguments. This is nice. What's not so nice is the rule for the abstraction, and well, they also like to have a choice, but then we have to make a tough choice. So let's look at it. So what we get here for the lambda is again we have no cost, so we put 0 on the terms file, and what's interesting, of course, is how we arrive at this function type here on tau prime. So of course we have to look at the function body. So what we want is, say, like, hey, we have some potential given by tau, and then P prime, tau prime. So something like that. We want to write. So the problem is, you could do that. That would be fine in a linear setting where you would use this function exactly once. If you would like to use the function multiple times, you can't do it like this. So the problem is that you might capture potential from the environment. So think about a pen, for instance, right? So a pen has a recurring version of a pen. The pen has a cost that is linear in the first argument. So but what happens if you partially apply a pen to just one list? You get a function as a result that takes a second list and gives you the dependent list. But the cost of this first application is probably 0 because nothing will happen, or just wait for this second list. And then what you have is a function whose cost is linear, but not in the argument, but in the first list that's not even there anymore. So now then you would say, like, okay, so this is a function, right? So the cost is 0 in the argument, so you can just call it without paying for anything. But yeah, this you can only do once. So then you would say, like, okay, I've kind of like prepaid it, and you can only do it once. If you wanted to use this function multiple times, that would be unsound, because then you would kind of like double spend. So this is the choice we have to make here, and the choice that I usually make is I say, like, okay, useful, but it's like with recursive functions, I think you want to apply multiple times as if you're older than this. So what I say here is, so this is like a notation, that the potential that you capture from the environment is zero. Yeah, so the this is a notation. Say you cannot, you know, capture potential from the environment when you define your functions. And so for the context, so this defined point was. Yeah, that's a bit sloppy, yeah, right, but like it's just the context where I kind of like erase the potential on all the types. That's the question.
So does that mean you can never increment that dependent function anymore?
Yeah, exactly. That's the consequence. You cannot write this dependent function. So what you could do is you could unquery it. That would work. What you could also do is you could switch the arguments. That would also work, but yeah, you can't write this append function anymore. And there are ways around it, so resource WML that works. So I mean, one possibility you have is to also introduce linear functions. Like you say, okay, you have both, right? And you can have like a linear function. Where you would allow it so that it would work, but like in resource WebML, we have another kind of like trick that is a bit more camel centric. And yeah, but it works out quite nicely. Yeah, I don't want to get into it, but this is kind of like yeah, a bit of a. Yeah, this is if you want to do resource analysis for kind of like a higher order programming language, so this is kind of like the pain point you have. So there have been multiple approaches. I mean, you can either kind of like give up like this, or you can prepay here for all the future users, right? So that's also possible. So like you say, okay, you have to have, if you want to use it 10 times, but usually you have something like, hey, you want to use it, you know, n plus m times in the future, and then things become really complicated. So another thing, I mean, what we do in resource aware ML, basically, we delay, if you want, this payment to the point when kind of like the later arguments come in. So that's another possibility you have. Okay, good. So one more rule, because it's very related, and then and this one. Still want to do because it's a similar, that's a fixed point. And I hope it is sound. But I think so. So let's see. This test type how. And now we also have to watch out with the capturing of the potential. So basically, what we want to say in the fixed point, well, no potential is involved at all. So neither the tau can have potential, nor the gamma. Yeah, and it's a bit restrictive in the sense, so like if you where to start your expression E with a tick, let's say, that wouldn't work at all, okay? But what you can do, I mean, usually, like in, you know, our function ID, you want to start with a lambda or something like that, that works. Or you could have, I mean, you don't have tuples in our language, or you could have like a tuple of functions, right, that works as long as you don't start with a tick. If you would have some cost for your tuples, yeah, so then yeah, it wouldn't work again. So maybe you can be a bit more permissive there, but I didn't find a good way. So what we usually do in ResourceML is kind of like we have you would say like kind of like the E that you have here has to have a particular form, namely a tuple of functions, and then kind of like you can count the cost for it kind of like at the outside for like the create function works, but that's kind of like a kind of very similar issue to the one here. But yeah, for all purposes, this means that should be good enough. Okay, so then yeah, next time we continue with the rules for lists, which are the probably most interesting ones, and then we talk about sums. Okay.